That is Tulu Kapi. That hill is Tulu Kapi. And it looks like a peaceful, serene place, and it is. And when I first arrived to have a look around 8 years ago, it was really enjoyable to go and visit. And my family came with me sometimes just to see what I'd got into, so to speak. And there were never any question, it was safe and quiet and peaceful, people lovely, invite you into their homes, and so on. It's not like that anymore. It's you think carefully now, security analysis every time you take a foot, because the country's become much more unpredictable. Why? Because that crazy thing called democracy got introduced. Democracy has taken the lid off bottled up rivalries and tensions that go back a long, long way. I'm not saying it's bad, but I'm saying it's not an autocratically run country anymore, and it's a country coming to grips with the birth of democracy. The standard disclaimer to say that anything I say about the future comes wrapped in caveats because I don't have a crystal ball. I won't dwell on the whole presentation. I won't try to read it all. I'll just say that what I glean is the important things to me. To me, KEFI was born in 2006. When I moved from Australia, the team I came to Cyprus with, we created three companies. We created what's now called Atalaya, a large copper producer in Spain. We created Venus, an emerging copper producer in Cyprus. And we created KEFI, which was a frontier prospector, an explorer in frontier markets. It went into Bulgaria, the Balkans, had a look at Northern Africa, and then got invited into the Arabian-Nubian Shield, run by a very successful, decent man as a prospector. And then when he'd led us into Ethiopia to buy Tulu Kapi, after that managing director had created a very strong exploration ethos and exploration team in Saudi Arabia, he put his hand up and said, "I'm not your developer, I'm not your financier, I'm not your negotiator. I just like to do prospecting. So let me go, I'll do prospecting, I'll help, but I'm not your developer." And Jeff Rayner, that fellow, still supports the company from a distance, and he spends most of his time working for the world's richest woman, Gina Rinehart, on her exploration ventures in different parts of the world as well. That's his two clients. But the birth of the company over the first 7 or 8 years under Jeff was to, if you like, latch onto the Arabian-Nubian Shield. And we set up a great intellectual property on the Arabian-Nubian Shield and some great exploration prowess on the Arabian-Nubian Shield. But regulations in Saudi Arabia stumped us. We weren't able to get moving, really, despite all that good work. It's only happening now. The last couple of years, it's come alive from a regulatory sense. So what's the moral of the story? Frontier markets, it's in the timing. You got to be ready, you got to be positioned, but it's in the timing, and the timing is controlled by other factors usually. Jeff led us into Tulu Kapi. These opportunities, one wouldn't pick up in Australia. I mean, these things are what you'd call, at a technical level, low-hanging fruit. But the politics and the regulatory systems are not easy to treat as if they're low-hanging fruit. They're difficult and challenging. Today, we have Tulu Kapi, and we have two advanced projects in Saudi Arabia, plus a pipeline of other projects. Partly the legacy of Jeff, going back all those years, but really now the creation of these teams that are in this company that you're not aware of, very strong teams in both countries. Those people created these projects. And those people I'm trying to highlight today very conspicuously, because the 50-odd people in each country will turn into several hundred in each country within 12 months. And that's the birth of a real mining company is about to happen. The value to KEFI of the two sides is about equal. And at this rate, Saudi Arabia is taking off more quickly, really, because it's moving fast now. The Saudi regime is a pedal to the metal type of attitude. And because there's no such thing as the issue of dealing with democratic rights and debates in Saudi Arabia, you go. In Ethiopia, there's a lot of discussion and debate before anything happens. What I would commend off this slide is one or two of the analyst reports. We paid a professional analyst to do a deep dive. He used to run the Macquarie Bank mining research desk in Australia. He's now in Hong Kong, Oriel Capital, this guy's team. We paid him to deep dive to write it up properly. So I recommend reading that if you really want to get your teeth into understanding what we're doing. Most brokers, analysts don't have the time to do a deep dive. They give it a superficial once over. Some of them are very decent analysts, but they don't have the time. Whereas that Oriel Capital report, he was paid to do a deep dive and he did his best. And I think he sort of got it, pretty well got it. The other thing I'll comment on is this funny aberration. The aberration of a stock spiking like that and then dropping like that. The first 3 months of the year, we fed the market a lot of information on what we were doing because the company was changing direction and its prospects changing. And the stock sat there, stock sat there, you can see, for months, not responding to all the information. And we hit the ground to do a corporate placing. And for the first time in my life, when we were doing a corporate placing, the stock took off. You know, I've always been worried about leaks and the stock going down. And for some reasons, the stock took off whilst we were actually marketing a placing. And then by the end of the placing, at market, no discount, which normally is a challenge, the stock heard of the placing and recovered it and sort of, adjusted itself to the placing price. The moral of the story is we typically don't suffer from leaks. That's a good thing. Another moral of the story is the stock's trying to run. It's trying to run on the slightest bit of news. And obviously it's quite volatile because of, you know, the risks and uncertainties that sometimes pop up in these markets. But it's trying to run because the NPV is so much higher than market cap. That the stock's wanting to run and it wants the milestones so it can run. That's my interpretation. I won't dwell on this. NPV is not a magic number, but it's the most commonly adopted measure. It's not the be-all and end-all, but it's the most commonly adopted measure. And you know, we can have long esoteric debates about it, but you know, typically a gold producer, their market cap as a producer, the discount rates are incredibly low on NPVs. Why? Because there's usually more gold than gets put into the model. Usually the deposit is not the shape that the engineer applies to it. The ore bodies continue beyond the mine design, typically. Anyhow, the main point is that today, the red thing is a market cap, which is about the same as Jibal Qutman's value to us today, and Hawiya and Tulu Kapi to us, our share of, are much bigger again. So clearly, as we de-risk, as we traverse the challenges and move forward, the market cap should start to reflect underlying value as we move forward and demonstrate that it's reality. This slide here is just saying that based on today's number of shares on issue, the value of the shares has moved from 3 to 9p in that period of time at the same metal price on the same number of shares. So if you like, what did management do? Management doesn't control the price of metals. Management, if you like, the dilution's the same, so you can see that's the impact on the numerator by what we've done to the assets of the company. And the numerator's value has tripled in that time. Basically because the Saudi Arabia's come alive and we've put some runs on the board there quite quickly. This is saying the same thing, but you know, you could do these statistics 100 times on 1,000 companies over time. There's about, today I'm not sure exactly, but it'd be something like 3,000 explorer developers in the world. Most of them don't get into development, and even fewer get into production. But that you can crunch these sorts of statistics every year, going back 50 years, and you'll see the same patterns. When they come into production, they trade more or less NPV, and then they move beyond NPV on other measures. And the question is, what is the investor's risk appetite? At which point does the investor try to get involved? Now, these are different companies that are being compared to KEFI, and KEFI is obviously the cheapest one, just because their share price is so low vis-a-vis NPV. But that's one thing that the graph is trying to convey. But the other thing that the graph pictorially represents to me is that as perceptions of risk based on progress change, the rating of KEFI will change to the rating of certain other stocks. You know, every stock is different and perceptions are different around every stock. But as the perception of risk and return changes, we already know what the potential value is. But as the perception changes, KEFI gets re-rated and to be more comparable to company X or company Y or whatever. And in production, it's up around 100% of NPV, typically a bit more, for the same reason I said earlier, there's typically more to come rather than just what the engineers put a design around for a mine. But today, it's about as cheap as it gets in this sector. And the question is, you know, what does it take to get it to the top? Three development projects plus exploration, two discoveries and one acquisition since 2006. I absolutely guarantee you, if the team that I came over to Cyprus with from Australia in 2005 had stayed in Australia, there's no way that one company, which is a frontier explorer, would have made two discoveries and one acquisition of this magnitude in Australia. Plus an explorer developer in Cyprus, plus now a major European copper producer. So there is low-hanging fruit in this part of the world for people from experienced mining jurisdictions. But the commercialization of them is the challenge. We've talked about values, we've talked about where we're heading. 400,000 ounce production at today's gold price, it's, what's that? It's $600 or $800 million a year of revenue. Half of it ours. From a standing start. Might sound like a long time, 2005, but to create, you know, this sort of company, that's a billion-dollar company. This is just putting out a conceptual sequence. These are conceptual graphs. Sometimes we get questions from shareholders. In your graph in March, you said 6.22, you said 10.22, and now you've said 11.22. You know, why are you changing? Hey, you know, this is conceptual, and it changes. The security, if we have a bad run, it'll change. I don't think we will, but it'll change. We're not going to put people at risk. Jibel Kutman, we were originally talking about 200,000 ounces of resource to be developed. Now, I think we're going to be going after 800,000 ounces of resource. So moving the target of the feasibility study to do a bigger job is a logical thing to do. Jibel Kutman, a year ago, it wasn't even on the sheet because it was stuck in no man's land in a regulatory system. Today it's here. And its production, there's a competition internally. Who's going to be in production first? But it wasn't even on the sheet a year ago. Circumstances changed. It's now on the sheet. This one's still growing. It's still the least predictable because it's still growing and it's got underground and open pit. So there's a number of things to work through there. We get a lot of questions about why haven't you closed this and why haven't you closed that? Perfectly logical questions. The simplest answer for predictability is to raise, what is it, between these three projects, the best part of $1 billion of capital to develop them. So if we all raised $1 billion, we could drive the timetable to our own liking. But if we want to put up only 10% of that $1 billion and end up controlling three projects, then we have to work with other people. Now the techniques are very standard, but the jurisdictions are not used to them. The techniques of raising capital for exploration, having JVs to fund part of that capital, that's very conventional. The techniques of doing 70-30 debt equity or 25-75 debt equity, very conventional for a robust project. But the jurisdiction, particularly Ethiopia, has never done it. So when we arrived in Ethiopia, you couldn't have an offshore account in London. You couldn't have market-based interest rates. You couldn't have hedging if you wanted to have hedging. You couldn't do leasing from overseas, and the local leasing companies didn't even know what we were talking about. I mean, all these things had to change to allow what we consider conventional project finance to be introduced. We had to do all that. We brought teams of experts to explain to the central bank and change things. So when people in Ethiopia say these guys haven't done anything for 7 years, well, we're more advanced than anybody else in the country. No one else has got anywhere near us in terms of development of a major project. And it's because regulations have changed around us as a consequence of our work to allow it to happen. A big difference in Saudi Arabia, huge difference, is that I think KEFI will barely have to lift a finger to arrange project finance because our partner is a leading industrial conglomerate who's very internationally experienced in business. They have the relationships in the finance world, and all the money that one is after is actually inside Saudi Arabia. So in Ethiopia, we have to collect experts with capital to come to the country. In Saudi Arabia, they have the background experience, they have the capital, they have the relationships. And Rich and I, who are on the board there, ask lots of questions and make sure we're comfortable, but the heavy lifting is being done by the team on the ground and our partner, really, on the things that take nearly all of our time in Ethiopia, really.
Harry, if I could just add there, the technical ground team on the ground is coming from KEFI.
Yeah, in Saudi Arabia, what happened was a very, very strong, very decent family office, the Al Rashid family, look it up on Google if you're interested, approached us and said, we've met with majors and we've heard about you guys. And they wanted to bring in technical experts to build a mining business. And instead of dealing with a fifth-rung management from a major, they wanted to deal with the people running the company and people who are more entrepreneurial and driven, perhaps, than the people that they'd met in the majors. And we said, well, we're not consultants. We only get involved where we have skin in the game and real upside for the company. So we cut this JV, essentially. And we basically drove it. We have appointed the CEOs, we appoint the teams, we do all the what is the mining stuff, right? We actually drive the industrial knowledge into the company. And it's, you know, for most of that, 2008 it started, so what's that, 14 years? Most of the time since, it's been terribly frustrating. We've done all the groundwork, the intellectual work, but haven't been able to get ahead. And now it's taking off. And it's going to be one of the major businesses of the Al Rashids, I'm sure. And they're giving it a lot of support now. Their concern is whether we can keep up, from their point of view, to be honest. Harry, Rich, can you keep up? This is going to grow. And little AIM-listed KEFI is going to struggle to keep up. Little AIM-listed KEFI has to grow up to keep up, really. That's what's going to happen next. Because it's a huge business in the making over there, and the Al Rashids are serious about it. And we're serious about it. And huge opportunity. And that's what we have to do. Closing procedures on project finance. Just dwelling for a moment on what just happened in the last week, which clearly caused great concern to shareholders, and the stock price and the stock volumes reflected that. And in the context of that slide, the slide, you can make it as bland as you like, and you could show the same slide in any jurisdiction, but not every company goes through the gyrations on its stock market that we just went through over the last week. I don't know what's happening to the stock today, but presumably it's recovered a bit, yeah? What's going on there? Well, you've got a country that has an underdeveloped business sector, an undeveloped mining sector, and passionate ambitions to grow it. And a very strong character of people, never been conquered. That's why the African Union's based there. Strong people, strident people. And, you know, how is it that a country maintains its independence, avoids European colonialism, unlike any other African country? How did they achieve that? Very decent people, very warm people, but how did they stay independent? Because they're skeptical and determined and suspicious and aggressive and ambitious and all of the above. And what's happening with KEFI is that we have brought this to the starting blocks. We're the first guys to have done that. Now, why has no one else done that in 30 years? Why has nobody else done that in 30 years? And now that we've done that, why is it that everybody who's interested in gold mining in Ethiopia is crawling all over it, jumping all over it, making accusations and trying to have a piece of it? I mean, common sense gives you the answers to those questions. But the underlying sequence of normal project finance is perfectly conventional. What's not conventional is the backdrop on the ground. And in the end, you have to have senior people on the ground all the time to deal with it. That's what Rich was kindly referring to about Harry as a chairman on whatever you said. It's about you only make it happen for the first time on the ground in a country that hasn't done it by being on the ground. You'd be quite surprised how strong our people are and the challenges we face all the time. And it'll change. And I'm sure that when we're up and running, everyone will say, you guys are lucky you were there first. It was lucky. Yeah, everyone will say that in due course. Tulu Kapi's got a long way to go before it's closed as a deposit. The last drill hole was 90 metres at 3 grams. There's a lot more going on there than we have any idea about yet. We have some ideas, but we don't know how far it keeps going and how big it is. Average underground mine globally, I don't know what it is, but 3 grams is a good grade internationally for a large mine in underground. This photo, to an experienced eye, and mine semi-experienced from an exploration viewpoint, but that is the surface expression of an ore body. And when you walk along, you see green stained rocks, which means there's copper. And it goes for kilometres, and no one had ever drilled it. Now, if that has been, that statement is flabbergasting. If that had been in Australia, it would have been drilled 100 years ago. But no one had even drilled it. Now, why did we've had three areas we could drill since we arrived in Saudi Arabia. Now we're going to get a lot more. We had three areas we could drill and we made two discoveries. And we actually spent a lot of money on the third one because we thought we had one, but it was a teaser. It never came good. The other two came good. And does that mean our guys are like unique? That they pick three targets and all three of them start stacking up and two of them are economic, robust development projects already? That is a unique statistic globally. Two out of three is a unique statistic globally. Usually it's about 3 out of 1,000. This one's 2 out of 3. And is it because our guys are like Superman and Superwoman, or is it because there's low-hanging fruit? You know, it's no disrespect to the guys, they've done a great job, but there's low-hanging fruit here. And there's more to go. That's why I don't still live in Australia. And this is half of the people who attended a meeting, the other half were on virtual participation, the financing syndicate of Tulu Kapi. Complex stuff. Lawyers who also act for the world's biggest mining company. So we don't shortcut the quality of the people in the syndicate. I'll just make that as one example. There are lots of companies who have come into that part of the world and everyone's watching us. You know, given what's happened, we're the first major development and everybody's interested. The world's two largest gold producers, these two, and very decent other companies are there and everyone's watching, wanting to see the first one go. Now the rest of it is, the rest of the presentation dives into the two countries. Well, this is just reiterating the points I've made about where we're heading here, that we've tripled value, that we've from our point of view, we're building this sort of operating cash flow. The economic metrics of Tulu Kapi are pretty decent. It's a conventional, what I call a conventional Kalgoorlie-style open pit CIL to be followed by underground, to use the sort of gold industry vernacular. How do you finance with project finance techniques a project of this nature? You wrap it in local partners who can help protect you. contractors who are first class, banks who bring a lot of expertise also to the table, particularly in a developing country, if they're two African development banks. And they have done that and brought that to the table. A metals trader who provides a different style of financing to stretch the normal envelope of debt equity. And some of these equity deals convert ultimately into KEFI shares, but at different dilution points to minimise dilution for today's shareholders. Over in Saudi, the diagram is very small compared to the Ethiopian one, because over in Saudi, the capital's there. We have a majority partner who's got the capital, and we have internal banks who have the capital. The development sequencing of Tulu Kapi, a schematic of what the plant looks like. That's the actual plant off the 3D design drawings, and the open pit schematic and the underground schematic. Saudi Arabia, same geology, but very different topography and demographics. You can't... you can stand on Jibal Qutman and Hawiya with binoculars and look around you 360 degrees and see nothing or no one. In Ethiopia, you stand still for 5 minutes and you're surrounded by six kids within 2 minutes. It's rich soil, thick vegetation, lots of people, but not so in Saudi. Now there's the government mining company called Ma'aden has pegged the obvious stuff. They've dominated the country's pegging before outsiders were let in. And we've been there long enough to cherry pick some other things, you might say, which is evidenced by the discovery rate. And we've got our eyes on half a dozen projects which are walk-up drill targets. And some of the ones we haven't got yet are of the same caliber in prospectivity as what we've drilled. So it's telling you that what's today two projects is pretty likely to be three, four, or five projects. That's how we are. It'll end up being a couple of open cuts at the top, and underground, and over in El Ghodia, which is 12 kilometres away. A parallel structure that similar, same sort of story. Jibal Qutman, as I say, at the beginning of the year we were thinking we'd be developing a couple of 100,000 ounces, and now we're thinking of more like 800,000 ounces to begin with. And it's essentially a string of little pits, like a string of pearls type of idea. Each one of them quite small, but a really good starter project, really good to get your systems in place and your organisation in place around a project like this. It's a really good starter project. I appreciate your patience. I'm happy to answer any questions that have been submitted. Well, first of all, from the floor, if anyone would like to raise a question. And then once, if we've dealt with any questions that are raised from the floor, happy to take some of, you know, the questions that might have come in beforehand by the website.
Well, thanks, Harry. I think a lot of the questions that people have submitted have been answered by the announcements this morning, and I've just ticked off three that you've just answered there on Tulu Kapi. One of the things that I have had questions on is sort of environment and away from security and financing, those sort of things. We've said construction at Tulu Kapi starts in the dry season or at the end of the wet season. How important is that? Because shareholders have seen with other, particularly African mining projects, where things have been delayed for considerable periods of time because it's too wet and you literally can't do anything. Is that a concern?
The wet isn't an issue. And the wet in Tulu Kapi is not like the wet season at the top end of Australia. The importance of it is that one has to do the initial earthworks and the foundations in the dry. And then when you get to the next wet season, you just keep going. So the wet of itself isn't the issue as long as you've got your foundations in and you can keep building. In terms of thinking through the sequencing on this one as compared to Saudi, here there's a... The first 6 months, if you visualise the first 6 months in Ethiopia, it's a lot of community work and moving people out of the way of the construction. And a lot of the construction activity is actually remote. Fabrication in different countries before it's delivered. And quarries, quarrying building materials to be delivered. And then, trigger 1st October, the first construction crew would be Q1 23. And during the balance of 22, there's fabrication off-site and there's community traffic and movement of people. And we've chopped the sequencing of the community side down into little bites so that each bite starts, stops, starts, a self-correcting system for the community to really get into a rhythm of how it's done and done well rather than trying to move 360 households in one hit.
No, thank you. I think that that addresses that. And so similar sorts of questions about Saudi. You mentioned the projects are effectively in the middle of nowhere. You can't see anything around. Is that actually an impediment to construction in terms of availability of infrastructure, water, people? Does it make it more difficult than Ethiopia?
Well, the water's more difficult. On these sites, there's basically two sources of water for these projects. Before you do your homework, there's two sources to consider. One is subsurface water, and Jibal Qutman, we're drilling water right now, and the problem we've had is we didn't have big enough pumps apparently to cope with the water flow. So the early indications are that that's not an issue. The second source of water is each of Jibal Qutman and Hawiya are not that far from major towns or cities. And one of the things one would look at if there was a problem with subsurface water is grey water, recycled city water. So that's the fallback. And we haven't got to the bottom of those two questions for both sites yet. But there's choices. But otherwise, no, it's not an issue. You bring in the workforce.
Okay. I had a few questions on exploration. And to ask a direct one, people are questioning why the company is looking at further exploration, in the adjacent areas when you've got fantastic projects going into production and shortly and in the coming years. Can't you wait until cash flows from those projects can fund?
Yeah, well, I think, we've got a... If the company stayed the same as it is today, and if the company doesn't really want to invest in exploration, then we shouldn't. If the company aspires to become a billion-dollar company and wishes to expand its share register to have company builders backing it, not short-term investors backing it, then it should go into exploration. And talk to the management of any established mining company, you'll see a conventional pyramid, which you must have seen in many situations, a pyramid of projects. And at the top, you'll have your mature producer. And at the bottom, you'll have a nursery of babies. And look how many years it's taken. Look how many years it's taken to get KEFI to where it is today, since 2006. And if we don't feed the bottom of the pyramid, I guarantee you the questions at the annual general meeting 1 or 2 or 3 years from now will be, why didn't you maintain your pyramid? Why are we now not going to have any growth after year four? No one's interested anymore. All you're going to do is report nuts and bolts from month to month, and you're not going to report growth. So you can't, how would I put it? Whilst on the one hand you have to keep your ears open to sentiment, really what you have to do is have a sensible business plan and do what you believe is right. And shareholders who want to be part of building an organisation that's going to be a serious mining company, self-select. Those who want to move on will move on. Those who want to be part of building a billion-dollar company will stay. And all you can do is what you believe is the right thing to do from a business strategy point of view.
Well, thank you, Harry. I think that basically covers all the areas that we've had. As I say, most of it was covered through the announcements this morning and what you've said earlier.
Thank you.
Thank you.